it's not always about marketing. It's about communication. It's about relationship building. It is about offers. Ultimately, it's about building your business. But if you go into it as just a promo vehicle, I think that's the wrong approach, and you're going to burn the customer out and kind of, you know, waste this amazing opportunity.
Welcome to Behind the Numbers Brand Anatomy, an all-new eMarketer podcast that looks under the hood of your favorite brands, made possible by Neustar. It's October 27th, and I'm your host, eMarketer Briefing Director Jeremy Goldman, and this is the show that gets inside brands and dives deep into one of their recent campaigns or discusses the ROI behind a new technology they've adopted. Today, we're talking with Ryan Alovis, founder and CEO of direct-to-consumer eyewear company LensDirect. Welcome, Ryan.
Thanks for having me, Jeremy. I appreciate it, man.
Yeah, great to be with you. Here's what we have on deck for you today. First, a speed intro where we get to know our guest in 100 seconds or less. Then, tell me something I don't know, where yours truly and this week's guest will bring a number, stat, or study that we find particularly fascinating and or relevant. And then we jump into this week's case study, how LensDirect leveraged subscriptions and agility to outperform and outpace the competition. All right, Ryan, time for your speed intro, where we get to know you and see how you think on your feet. 100 seconds on the clock. Our producer, Victoria, will be timing you. You ready?
I'm ready. I just drank a little Gatorade. Put me in, coach.
Sounds good. Your time starts now. Where are you from?
I'm from Long Island, New York.
What is your primary goal at LensDirect?
To build a company that has a fantastic pulse, great customers, and longevity.
What did you think of the Squid Game?
I liked it. Disappointing ending, but very, very intense and lovely show that pulled me in and was exciting from start to almost finish.
I just wish it had more blood and violence. That was my only problem with it. Does pineapple belong on pizza?
Never.
How many unread emails are in your inbox?
Zero.
Wow.
Maybe three since we started the podcast.
Fair enough. I'll keep you on for longer. It'll be like 11. Who's one business leader you especially admire?
Jeff Bezos.
I've never heard of the guy. You wake up and learn that the earth will explode in 3 hours. What do you do with that time?
Hug my kids and finally microwave those White Castle sliders in the freezer.
That's the second time White Castle has come up today, and it's only 9:45 a.m. I'm not kidding. And favorite marketing or business book of the last few years?
I would say Rich Dad, Poor Dad. A book also that most people have never heard of.
Believe it or not, a Uber driver in Orlando gave it to me, and that was the best Uber I've ever had. Good call. And you totally won. Congratulations. How do you feel?
I feel like I should go get those White Castle burgers.
There you go. But yeah, no, I'm really excited to talk to you. We're going to get into the case study in a second, but first, it's time for Tell Me Something I Don't Know. This is the segment where we each bring an interesting number, stat, study, or finding that most folks wouldn't know about, but will be highly relevant to brand marketers, and we explain why we think it matters. Here's what I'm bringing, Ryan. According to eMarketer, U.S. direct-to-consumer sales, they're on a tear. Okay, they're growing at about 17%, we're projecting, from 2021 to 2022. That's not the same as the 45.4% from 2019 to 2020, but there were obvious black swan reasons for that to happen. Now, how do you feel about that 17% number? Does that seem about right to you? What do you think about D2C in general? Thoughts?
So the number seems, it actually feels somewhat conservative. I believe it's looking at a holistic picture, but for us at LensDirect, we're growing significantly faster. I mean, it's taking this big amount of data. It's kind of giving you these numbers at 18%, which I actually read recently, it is 18%. It's amazing to see it. And I bet if you looked at, obviously, you know, the late 90s to mid or 2010s, you'd see something wildly different. It's accelerated. I think it's faster. It's going to start moving much faster. And I think with COVID, it amplified those numbers just so significantly.
But what do you think about, you know, just behaviors changing? You know, is that, and I think that this is one thing that a lot of people come down to is, are some of these behaviors permanent, or just do people go back to the way that things were before and then they just say, you know what, I just really want to go out and buy lenses in person for some reason?
Right. I mean, it's something that we're all trying to figure out day in and day out. There's no clear answer yet. I think, you know, the jury's out on that. But I will say for LensDirect specifically, over the past 2 years from 19 to 20, I mean, we grew by well over 200%. from 20 to 21, we're hitting numbers that are significant as well. So we don't see this pattern changing so much. We've done internal surveys, and we really also believe the customers are ready for e-com and they want to stick with e-com. They want convenience. The experience is better. So yeah, of course, there's going to be the people that are romantic with the in-person experience and they're going and they're touching and they're feeling. But for the vast majority of people, they're going to opt for convenience and they're going to order those products online and they're going to enjoy it. And it's going to be more affordable as well, for optionality is a big deal.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. You definitely see with some things, there are some benefits, obviously, to having physical retail, which I want to actually talk to you about a little bit in the case study segment. But before we get to that, I want to ask you about your data. You know, what are you bringing?
Yeah, so, you know, I think one of the key points that we've seen and something that's very special, and I believe a lot of companies need to really look at the way that they're selling their product, is built around subscriptions. There is a research done recently on surveys, and it's come out to 25% of consumers are using direct-to-consumer subscriptions exclusively. We at LensDirect have always known that to be such a significant component that we needed to dial down on. I don't believe companies are looking at it nearly enough. I think companies are resting in their laurels and selling onesies and twosies, where they should be looking at their business and going, how do we make this a subscription-driven product? And I'm not saying, you know, you go all in and that's the end of it. I believe you kind of should. But pick a component of your business and over time, create a subscription model around it. So, you know, the consumers made it abundantly clear they want subscriptions. They want the convenience of subscriptions. And it's our job as business owners or people that work within a company to support that initiative.
I was covering D2Cs a lot throughout 2021, and it seems to me one of the things that brands struggle with is to figure out if they are a subscription product or not, right? There are some things that are kind of obvious, I feel like lenses or, you know, shaving equipment, right?
Magazines.
But how do you decide if you're a brand where you're kind of in the gray zone, if you can turn this into a subscription business?
I'm not saying every business or every company is going to have to go down that road. Obviously, you know, there's going to be restrictions for few. But I do really believe that the vast majority of companies, if they look deep down enough and they looked at their products and their categories and who they're competing with, there has to be an element of continuity or some level of recurring revenue. Obviously, with LensDirect, contact lenses, super easy, right? You know, it smacks you right in the face. Every 3 months, you need your lenses. Every 6 months. And we went all in on that with our auto refill program. But I've looked at other businesses and other industries, and there's always an element of recurring revenue subscriptions where there's convenience that's discounted. So it's there, but again, like you said, it's not always going to be there.
Yeah, and I'm really actually excited to dive into that in the case study portion in a second. But first, we're going to take a quick word from our sponsor, Neustar, and then we'll be right back.
Are you prepared for marketing's next chapter? You won't want to miss Brave New Worlds 2021, the virtual marketing and analytics event of the year on November 9th and 10th. Join Brave New Worlds to learn how you can adapt to the forces redefining advertising. It's free, and you'll hear from today's top minds in marketing, data, and analytics, including executives from Facebook, General Motors, Capgemini, Publicis, and more. Go to bravenewworlds.newstar to register today.
All right, now it's time for our brief case study, where we look at a recent brand campaign or deployment and discuss what went right and some learnings for next time. Okay, so Ryan, I wanted to ask you, how did you pivot towards leveraging subscriptions as a business?
So candidly, I was blessed to be in a business prior to LensDirect called Magazine Discount Center. And the entire thesis of that company was auto-renew. It was magazine subscriptions, set it, forget it. You'd get your Sports Illustrated, your Good Housekeeping. So I was really fortunate to have experience within the category of subscription modeling. So with LensDirect, when I actually took over the business, it was not a company that had the subscription component. It was a business that we assumed, and you know, we were super naive actually, that customers would just come back when they were running low in their contacts. We were wrong. We were very wrong. So I could tell you, I stripped the whole company and I put the auto refill, I branded it, which I think most companies really should do. I stripped the entire company and I put all eyes on auto refill. I made everything the customer saw and touched about auto refill, from when they were checking out to when they were shopping to their emails to when we were sending them notes about running low in their contacts, when a product was out of stock. Everything we did became auto refill driven and subscription driven. It was not easy, I'll be honest with you, but it was worth it.
How do you balance, though, I'm wondering, the customer experience, which obviously it gets better when you offer subscriptions, but at the same time, you know, how do you make sure that you offer people exactly what they want? And what if they don't want subscriptions, you know, want to push somebody to something that makes them unhappy in the end, right? So how do you balance those two pressing needs?
Yeah, well, you certainly have to be careful. I've seen subscription businesses go the opposite. You know, they're going down fast. And when you don't put the customer first and their happiness first and their ability to make decisions and changes first, you're going in the wrong direction. We don't do that. With LensDirect, we are really customer centric. And I know that a lot of companies say that, but we really live and die by the customer. We know that any company can just buy a customer with having a really good, cheap price. It takes a really great company to keep that customer. So, you know, we give a ton of opportunity to bow out of that subscription, to edit that subscription, to pause the subscription, to get it faster. And I think companies can really learn a lot with this key component. It's all about communication and transparency. Build the right technology that is transparent at its core. Teach the customer care team to always accept and understand that, you know, the customer is allowed to make changes and that's it. And it's completely fine. Never lock someone in. I think that's going to be the kiss of death if you do that.
I think that's really good advice. I mean, I'm wondering what percentage have you been able to convert over to subscriptions in general? And I'm wondering in part because obviously as a smaller player going up against some Goliaths, you have to, you know, focus on profitability so that you can reinvest in marketing. So about what percentage are you able to share anything along those lines?
Yeah, I'm happy to do it. And it's really grown every year. Right now, I mean, roughly 35 to 40% of our customer base on the contact lens category of LensDirect, they're on subscription. And I just want to be very clear about why it's so important. I know the idea of continuity and recurring revenue is really exciting, but the most exciting part for me about subscription modeling is the profit is really there. So, you know, buying a customer for most companies is really expensive, right? That CPA, that cost per acquisition, it's very expensive. A lot of companies lose money on that initial purchase. The reason that subscriptions matter so much to companies is that you have that customer. They're a part of your ecosystem. They're part of your family. So the margin will be represented in their long-term buying behavior.
Some of the other cool things that you guys are doing. With respect to subscriptions, what are some of the other things that people have to know if they want to be successful? Because I imagine it's not as simple as just, you know, having a replenish now button on your homepage. There's something that to be said for all of the work on the back end that you have to do in order to make this work.
Yeah. Well, I think thankfully for a lot of the companies out there, there's a ton of good technology that you can leverage for managing that subscription component for your business. We built an internal platform because we knew that it was just so important to us. We didn't want to rely on anybody but ourselves. But one thing that I have not mentioned, and it's very important to note, is that the beauty of subscription, of course, better margin, you know, a customer that sticks with you, but also on the inventory side. Remember, when you have subscribers, you have predictable inventory modeling behavior, right? You know what to expect. You know what to buy. You know what to have. You need to be careful. So while you have these great insights, you also need to be able to perform, right? There's something to be said about somebody that gets that subscription, that product when they want it, when they signed up for it, but hell hath no fury like someone that is on subscription and you don't have the inventory to service them. So it sort of defeats the whole purpose. So just, you have to be careful. There's a lot of nuances involved in it. Don't rush into it. But also, don't be so patient. Try little nuggets here and there. Get involved and start the engine.
I love that, you know, having a good amount of impatience and how it can serve you well. I wanted to ask you, what marketing channels have you used to message your offerings? What have you found to be most effective in terms of, you know, bringing the customer in and retaining them?
Yeah, absolutely. So just like every other e-commerce company, we're always going to be doing a lot of email. We're doing a lot of the other channels from paid social, paid search, affiliate marketing. But I'll tell you, the most exciting and for sure the greatest lift that we've seen is via SMS marketing. SMS marketing, we actually use, and I really recommend these guys, Attentive, phenomenal company. They really helped us get into that space in a dramatic fashion. Our metrics there that we've seen with Attentive on SMS are blowing everything out by significant amount. So, you know, we're seeing certain metrics, for example, exit intent. When someone goes to LensDirect and they look to leave the website, we're leveraging Attentive's technology, and we're seeing 11% of these people opting in to receive SMS communication. That's just 11% for people opting in for SMS. We're utilizing Attentive. People are signing up to also get email notifications and updates. 17% we're seeing from that. We're seeing signups when people go to the website. We're immediately hitting them with an offer. We're seeing 19% of these people are signing up with their email to get that coupon. I cannot tell you how important SMS marketing is. And if you're not doing it, you're really just hurting yourself and the business and the customer experience.
So I actually wrote the SMS report for eMarketer in the last year. So this is something I know a little bit about, but it's interesting. People use it in a lot of different ways. Some people think of it as an email substitute. And I've actually spoken to a lot of people who will argue that it's in some ways an email enforcement. And, you know, it reinforces the email and the email will reinforce the SMS. And, you know, there's a little bit of a value in all of these channels playing against one another. What do you think on that?
Well, I think that's absolutely correct. What I've learned in my, you know, career with e-commerce is that it's never just one thing. Everything has to support each other. Everything has to work in tandem. And email has an amazing place in e-commerce. SMS, amazing place in e-commerce. I can tell you just as a general consumer, when I purchase something and I get notified where it is or when it's delivered by SMS, there's an amazing feeling there. You feel like you're having a personal connection with a brand. So, you know, everything does matter. I could tell you on the contact lens side, when we talk about subscription, SMS is critical, right? Now we're sending out messages to people when their low supply is up and all they need to do is type back refill and immediately, boom, their order goes into the system and ships out. So SMS, email, they could be used in a variety of ways. It's not always about marketing. It's about communication. It's about relationship building. It is about offers. Ultimately, it's about building your business. But if you go into it as just a promo vehicle, I think that's the wrong approach and you're going to burn the customer out and kind of, you know, waste this amazing opportunity.
People talk about the benefits of scale, but in my opinion, they don't talk enough about the benefits of sometimes being smaller and, you know, asymmetric warfare. How has being smaller helped you be more nimble and agile at adopting new technologies and trying out new things?
I can't speak for what it would be like if we were, you know, a publicly traded Fortune 100 company, but I could speak to how agile we are as LensDirect. I could tell you that over the past few years, just to give some context on the company, historically, we've been a contact lens online retailer. Over the past 2 years, we've become a full vision care online retailer. So what does that mean? That means we don't just sell contact lenses anymore. We're selling eyeglasses. We're selling sunglasses. We're replacing the lenses in your frames that you have and you love and you don't want to spend all this money and waste all this time going to the store. The key thing I'm bringing up and why I'm saying who we are now and who we were then is because if we were much larger, we'd probably have a lot more challenges and roadblocks and shifting strategy. We believe, and I am fully of the mind where, you know, we have to move fast. Obviously, we're not just like taking insane risk and, you know, leveraging the company and going in that direction. But we've become a vision care company and an optical company. We've started leveraging SMS. We've made massive investments in technology in our eyewear laboratory because we are nimble and we are small. And when we have a meeting, we listen to everybody and people have the power of voice and we're allowing things to take place.
I think what's also interesting is, you know, I tell me if I'm wrong, but you're largely bootstrapped, no?
Fully bootstrapped. I've never raised $1 of outside capital. It's been slow and steady, sort of roll your sleeves up and grow in a healthy manner. So yeah, we're totally bootstrapped. We've definitely entertained outside capital in the past and what it could do for us from an amplification perspective. And I think there's something to be said about going it alone in the beginning because you're going to learn a lot about yourself and the customer and the company and how to take educated risk and grow a healthy business.
Yeah, no, it's just interesting considering I was literally the other day writing a story about a $1 billion with a B dollar raise. And, you know, you don't see as many companies that necessarily see the virtues and the benefits towards, you know, going it their own way and having that full control over what they're trying to do with the brand.
Yeah, it's been a blessing. And listen, at times, obviously, it's a curse. It's a scary thing. It's a daunting journey. And there are really great days and there are bad days, just like everything else. Obviously, money helps when you have a lot of it in the bank and it's someone else's money. Maybe that helps even more. I don't know. But I believe that you know, to be really successful, or at least be successful and build a good business, you need to be excited about change and you need to embrace the change culture. And I believe it can be easier when you do it alone, and it could be easier with the right partner. Believe me, I know there are great companies out there that have raised a lot of money for the right reasons with the right partner. And I mean, they're just exceptional businesses run by exceptional people. So I applaud both sides of the aisle.
Okay, I know I have to let you go in a minute or two, but one thing I really have to ask you is, you know, no manager, no marketer is doing all things right. What's something that you wish that you would have done differently, especially in the last year or so?
Something that I wish I had done differently, you know, I know we move really quickly in certain categories, but there are categories that we don't. You know, I wish that I had gone into the optical side of the business earlier. That's a key thing. And another large aspect of it is I wish I went way harder on building a mobile application and, you know, a native experience for the consumer and the customer to manage their relationship with us. I mean, these are all things that we're doing and we're trying our best, but I wish I had listened and moved faster in certain things, and that would have been a win.
Well, we got to leave on one more positive note. So last question, what are, you know, some of the disadvantages of D2C, and how are you trying to mitigate against them? Because D2C is not perfect in some ways because people do like to shop physically, but how do you, as a D2C, essentially kind of acknowledge those things and then try to work to enhance the customer experience?
Very good question. So DTC is the landscape that, because it's 2021 and there's so much transparency in the market with every review site, I mean, I can name like 100 right now, bad companies can't hide out anymore. When you do a bad job, it is there. It's online. People are reviewing and they're rating. So for us at LensDirect, you know, we're not immune to these bad reviews. And what I think matters the most in the world when you're a company, I mean, DTC or B2B, whoever you are, you respond to those reviews and you make the right changes. I don't think as a company in 2021, you could just hide behind a brand. I think you need to be vocal. I think you need to be communicative. I think you need to accept that not every experience is going to always be a positive one. But I think the ones that win are the ones that see those negative reviews and those negative experiences, and they do whatever they can to turn it around and build a long-term relationship and just say the most amazing thing you could ever hear. I'm sorry.
I've never had an interview end with the words, I'm sorry, and apology accepted. But no, Ryan, thank you so much. This was great.
I appreciate it, man. Jeremy, thank you so much for having me, guys. I had a great time.
Well, that's it for today's episode. Let us know what you think. We'd love to hear from you at podcast@emarketer.com. I'll be back in 2 weeks for another episode of the Behind the Numbers Brand Anatomy. Make sure to tune in tomorrow for the Behind the Numbers Daily, an eMarketer podcast made possible by Neustar.